Seniors and friends, good evening and welcome to the Lex Ponder lecture series organized by the NKM Law Chambers. Today we have with us senior advocate Ms. Aishwarya Patil from the Supreme Court, who is a renowned senior advocate, popularly called the junior senior, who was designated in 2019 and is one among the youngest senior advocates in the Supreme Court history. And in fact, to her credit, she is the youngest woman advocate to be designated as senior advocate by the Supreme Court. In the last several years, she has carved a niche for herself in the Supreme Court, not just for the acumen of law, but for her courtcraft. And in fact, on a personal note, I have seen her in many matters where she tackles the bench in all tricky situations with depth. As juniors, it is something that we learn from Mrs. Patil. And she has appeared in very, many number of matters. And as we all know, most recently we had the commissioning of women in the Indian Army. And the chief architect of the matter was none other than Mrs. Patil. And I think the topic that we have taken today, the women, the Supreme Court and the Constitution, the march of law, is certainly something that Mrs. Patil would do perfect justice to, and the subject is close to our heart. So it's an honor and a privilege to have her amidst us. Ma'am, thank you very much for accepting our invitation. It's certainly an honor and a privilege to host you. Ma'am, I'll leave it to you, ma'am, after the formalities are done. I think participants are joining. By the minute, but I think since the clock has crossed 5:15, I think we leave it to you, ma'am. Please welcome to the lecture. I leave it to you for today's lecture. Please.
Thank you so much, Naveenji, for that very, very generous introduction that you gave and the personal anecdotes that you had.
Volume, if you can make it a little higher. Volume is slightly low.
Is this better?
Slightly higher.
I don't think I have the volume control for the mic.
Varsha, can you just increase the volume for ma'am, please?
Ma'am, your output is fine, ma'am. I think you can begin. Now it is.
Yes. Okay, thank you. So, better, Naveenji, can you hear me?
Yes, I'll
be louder also. So, first of all, let me thank Naveenji for the extremely generous introduction and in adding some very interesting catchy phrases there, which warm up anybody's heart, and so do mine. I don't think I deserve those beautiful and very generous words that he has spoken for me, but to be here is a privilege. It's an honor. Naveenji and I had been speaking about a conference from prior to lockdown. And am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. I think Varsha, please unmute everyone.
Okay, so I'll continue if that's fine, Naveenji. Okay, I'll just presume that I'm audible till somebody points out that I'm not. Looks like it's working fine from my end. So, like I mentioned, Naveenji and I had been in this discussion for some time, and then the lockdown happened, and then we postponed it, obviously, like all other things. And then, to have a webinar, and this topic was also something that we discussed, and we were both equally enthused and enthusiastic about having this topic, having this webinar. And frankly, it is a privilege and honor to be here this evening. It's an honor when your colleagues from across the country, when your friends and your seniors from the profession and your juniors from the profession, when they take the time out, they hear you out, and what is assigned to you is a journey of law which you have practiced, which you have been part of, which you relate to as a woman more. I don't really claim myself to be a feminist, but certainly there are some portions of which I've experienced myself. So thank you for giving me this space and this beautiful topic, Naveenji. So women, Supreme Court, Constitution, and the March of Law. That is what has been assigned to me. Let's start with the Constitution. I think what is really heartening and very exciting for all of us as students of law to understand is that when we started our journey as a young republic, democratic country, our founding fathers made this code for us, this grand norm, it's our Gita, it's our Bible, it's what we swear by. The Constitution of India is not just amongst the longest written, in fact, it is the longest written constitution of the world, but it is also one of the most respected constitutions of the world. And when we had our constitution, it was interesting because we are talking about a period which is not 2020. I'm taking you back to a period which is between 1947 to 1949. When the constitution was being framed by our constituent assembly, by our founding fathers. It is heartening to note that, while the world around us was going through an extreme turmoil when it concerned gender rights and when it concerned racial discrimination and various other issues with regard to liberty, equality, fraternity, we chose to give ourselves, our founding fathers gave to us, and we chose to give to ourselves a constitution, which was so progressive that from the day go, there was equality in true sense and purport for women. So like the Western world, like the developed countries, women did not have to battle for universal adult franchise. Women did not have to battle for equal spaces, equal protection of laws, equal opportunities in public employment. That was a given. So it was very, very important and sacrosanct principles that were ingrained in our constitution to make sure that gender equality doesn't remain just a lip service, but it is firmly and very deeply affirmed and ingrained in the constitution. I mentioned adult franchise because adult franchise was something that women have been able to achieve for themselves, which is a victory and which is not too long back. It was in the Western world also, it's just about 100 years old, 100 plus years old. And that it's not too far back. And while the constitution is, our constitution is also known as, it's the amalgamation of best practices of the world. It's like a bag of borrowings. But we were careful and cautious to not take the negatives of the best of the worlds where we were taking the best practices from. For example, our fundamental rights, which is deeply influenced by the Bill of Rights of the United States of America. US at that time was still still grappling with racial discrimination. Of course, recently also we have seen some of the incidents, they keep coming back. But at that time, let me remind you, the US of that time, for them it was okay to be separate, was considered as equal. So you could have separate restaurants, separate schools, separate portions in the buses for African Americans, and that was considered as equality. But look at the beauty of our constitution, that not only did it provide equal protection of laws, but it went a step further. We ingrained the concept of affirmative action. Affirmative action to ensure that truly there is equal treatment of equals, and categories of citizens who had been discriminated against for centuries, and who obviously had that baggage of discrimination, their shoulders lugging that baggage of discrimination. Affirmative action was required by states to ensure that there is true equality. Women and children fell in that category also by virtue of Article 15. And it was incumbent on states to ensure that some affirmative action is done to ensure that women and children are treated as a separate class and there are special protection of laws available to them. So equality very clearly defined in Article 14, 15, in public employment, Article 16. And the entire line and length of Part 3 of the Constitution. And then very interestingly, some of the provisions which could not find place in Part 3, we were a young democratic republic. What we aspired for as a nation, we could not achieve all of it on day one. So that aspiration, that direction forms Part 4 of the Constitution, which is in the form of directive principles of state policy. And in the directive principles of state policy also, some of the provisions which have been prescribed in our constitution for women, so that nations and governments and authorities work in that direction are incredible. Some of the interesting provisions in part 4 of our constitution is Article 38, which talks about a social order for the promotion of welfare of all its people. You know, then it is right to work, education, public assistance, and 42 provisions of just and human conditions of work and maternity relief. We have seen now in statutorily, we have maternity relief, which is which is at par with the maternity relief which is given across the world. And maternity is not seen as a disadvantage, at least not by law. Of course, that we'll come to it when we discuss the judgments. But the law does not prescribe or allow maternity to be seen as a burden or a disadvantage of any form, and actually allows the woman equal opportunities and a special leave in the cases of maternity. Then there is equal pay for equal work, living wages, etc. And interestingly, uniform civil code for its citizens. Unfortunately, the provision with regard to uniform civil code, Article 44, has remained a mirage despite over 73 years. And we this is also one provision that has to change, because what really remains for women, which is really disadvantages to women in the form of uniform civil code, is that while all our other civil rights, all our other civil relationships, which may be anything, the way, you know, where we work, employer, employee, how we make our houses, how we pay our taxes, electricity, how we walk on the road, how we set up companies, how we set up partnerships, all other aspects of our civil relationships are all governed by gender neutral and religion neutral laws. But the one aspect where women are at the receiving end the most, which is their domestic households, which is where it all starts. There, women continue to be disadvantaged position and oppressed in many, many cases, because there is no uniform civil code, and in a sense, there's no uniformity, there's no gender neutral and religion neutral laws when it comes to our marriages, our maintenance, our divorce, succession, custody issues. Of course, succession is now out of it. And now, after the Juvenile Justice Act and the CARA guidelines and Supreme Court judgments, adoption is something that is gender neutral and religion neutral. But succession, marriage, divorce, maintenance, alimony, custody, these are issues which are still, it's our personal laws that are governing. A huge pitfall, a huge red flag, but then in a sense, it was a very beautifully ingrained rights of women in the constitution. Now let's look at how the journey has been of the constitution, which is the journey has been mostly taken forward by the Supreme Court. No doubt the Indian Supreme Court has been like a lighthouse, not just for our robust democracy, but also to ensure that rights, especially rights with regard to gender justice, gender dignity, and gender equality are affirmed, are formulated, and are deeply respected to ensure that there is equality in its true sense. Journey hasn't been easy. It is said in that in a very beautiful judgment that fundamental rights are like empty vessels. Every generation fills those empty vessels with the wisdom of its own times. So we have also, generations of Indians have filled up the part 3 vessels with the wisdom of its own generation and its own time. And that makes for a very interesting and very beautiful journey for women also, when we speak about how Supreme Court has been a guiding light, by being a lighthouse, and how it has impacted and molded that journey. Some of the keynote, some of the landmark judgments which actually caused a paradigm shift in that journey, I would like to speak about. And you know, starting from maybe we can, if we can divide it into portions, we start with the judgments with regard to personal laws. You know, what was interesting to note was one aspect of maintenance, which was then included in Section 125 of the new CRPC, came up for consideration in the famous case of Shah Bano in the 1970s. And despite there being no uniform civil code, despite all of us being governed by our personal laws, the Supreme Court went on to say that under the CRPC, since the maintenance is provided under CRPC Section 125 and all of us, it applies to all of us equally. We have uniform criminal code. We have had since the time of the British, since Macaulay gave us the Indian Penal Code, and CRPC, of course, kept on amending. But ever since that, so the uniformity of the criminal code is sacrosanct, and Muslim women are entitled to maintenance under Section 125 of CRPC. Of course, there was a huge uproar against that judgment by particular sections of our citizens and our society. And populism also got the better of the government of that time, and the government came up with an act which is ironically called the Protection of Muslim Women at the Time of Divorce Act, but it actually took away the protection, it actually took away the benefit and the advantage that was given by the Supreme Court in the Shah Bano's judgment. The Supreme Court also said that, it lamented that we hadn't, India hadn't had a uniform civil code so far, and I think, and they felt that it was time that legislature ought to take a call on Article 44 of the Constitution. Anyways, that remained. Then we saw a category of judgments with regard to personal laws. We saw Sarla Mudgal, where in a different way there was a challenge where a couple was married under the Hindu laws. They were governed by Hindu personal laws, but the man converted into Islam and married another woman who was also professing Islam. So now under the Islamic law, that marriage was, there was no problem with that marriage. But under the Hindu law, there was a problem clearly, because bigamy was not permitted under the Hindu law. So that interesting and very twisted question came up before the Supreme Court. And in affirming very clearly again, rising up to the justice that was required from a judgment like that, the Supreme Court said that even if maybe it may seem to be valid under one personal law, any spouse who people who are married under personal laws, this practice cannot be allowed to go on. And if a person marries somebody else even after converting, it will amount to bigamy, and the person can be proceeded against for the section of bigamy. And that second marriage will be treated to be null and void under law. So that was another facet of the personal law being decided in that manner. And the journey went on. We saw another very interesting case was the Hariharan case, Geeta Hariharan versus Reserve Bank of India. In this judgment, again, this took it to a different dimension. Under the Hindu Succession Act, the mother was entitled to be the guardian of the child after the father. So that after the father was interpreted as after the death of the father. But that was questioned and challenged, and the Supreme Court felt compelled to say that after cannot be interpreted in a manner to say just after the death of the father. And if the father is temporarily or permanently absent from his parenting duties, and the mother is there, so mother will not play a second fiddle to the father, and mother is entitled to be the guardian of the child, and she doesn't have to disclose who the father is, and she's the law allows that kind of an interpretation, that a mother can be the guardian of the child. So this recognizing the woman, the mother, as a equal partner in law as a guardian for the child was to my mind again a very important pillar and landmark when it came to Supreme Court deciding on personal laws. And recently we saw that, of course not too recently, but 4 years back, we saw the challenge again to the triple talaq, which was again a practice under the personal law, and this time we saw that though the minority did put the ball in the court of the legislature again. However, the majority vehemently and determiningly came down against it and declared it as unconstitutional. Now, that majority judgment is interesting because a part of the majority judgment says it is arbitrary as per the constitution and it is unconstitutional. Whereas one part of the majority judgment finds it to be bad because it is bad even under the personal law of the Muslims. So it's an interesting gel. And then we saw, of course, the Sabarimala judgment, which you know, I urge you to see not just Sabarimala as the one judgment of the Supreme Court, because that is up in review. We have to wait and see what comes out of the review. But that judgment and that case gave a movement to, you know, entry of women in places of worship, which were otherwise they were banned from. So we saw high courts dealing with cases like entry of women in the Shani Shignapur temple, in the Haji Ali Dargah, and several other cases. And, you know, if one case happens, others, you know, they just, there's a domino's effect. So one judgment by the Supreme Court actually has an impact of allowing, opening doors even without litigation for others. Remains to be seen what comes out of the review. There are some other personal law practices which are also challenged. But this Sabarimala judgment did mark a very important paradigm, a very important milestone for the journey of women in personal laws. So that is, and in law, for succession laws, we saw, you know, we saw a different journey, and it was initially when the constitution came at that time, the rights which were available to women were not, before the independence, they did not have right to hold property on their own. But only Sridhan was something that they could hold on their own. But then with the coming of our codification of our personal laws, at least some portions of those personal laws, we saw that women were recognized as owners, and they were given the rights to hold properties in their own right, in their own sense. But we also saw that it took a long while, and it was only in 2005 that we saw the specific and categoric amendment came in the Hindu Succession Act, allowing women or treating women to be a co-partner. Before 2005, women was not treated as a co-partner, and but by an amendment of law. Then we saw some interesting judgments post 2005, where Supreme Court even went on to say that even a Hindu woman can be a karta, which was something that was traditionally understood to be the role played by men, the eldest man of the house and exclusive domain of men. But the Supreme Court said that even a woman could be a karta, and there is no disqualification. We also saw some cases where, you know, other forms of discrimination in personal laws were struck down by Supreme Court. Now let's go on to some other aspects of this journey. Vishakha has been one judgment which has been a paradigm shift, not just for gender justice laws, but also to it's a landmark judgment also because it Supreme Court does not lay down law. That's not the role that is prescribed to our courts under our constitution, and they examine the validity of laws, judicial review, sure. And if they find the law to be unconstitutional, they strike it down. But then it is again left to the legislator to do its job and come up with a law or frame another law to remove the mischief for which they had formed the law. But we saw in Vishakha's case, which again came out of very, very gory facts from my state, Bhavri Devi was a Sathin. Sathin are these village workers, like Anganwadi workers, who are women from that village only, and these women are given the role of ensuring that there is awareness about, of medical hygiene, of child maternity issues and childbirth issues. There is awareness about social evils like child marriage, the government policies and the plans and other benefits which are given by authorities from time to time are communicated. So she is like that link in the rural parts of the country for between the governmental policies, awareness, and the general folks of the village. So Bhamari Devi was a Sathin in a small village in Rajasthan, and when she got to know that in a particular family there were going to be multiple child marriages on a particular day, and this was a family it was a feudal family, so it was an upper community family. She complained to the authorities. First, she tried to intervene with the family. They obviously did not listen to her. Then she brought in the authorities, and with the intervention of the authorities, those child marriages were stopped. And she was doing her job. That was her job, to create awareness and to point out to authorities wherever child marriages are happening. We've had child marriages have been illegal in our country for a long time, but it continues as a social taboo. It continues, unfortunately. But see what happens to her. This family is outraged. The men of this family are outraged that how dare this lowly woman, complain to the authorities and stop marriages in our family. So how is she rewarded? She is gang raped by 4 or 5 men of that family. And when she, it's if you read her account, it's harrowing, because when she went to the police station to lodge an FIR, they actually kept women in the rural area wear a lehenga. It is like a, it's called ghagra lehenga. It's like a long plaited skirt. They kept her lehenga, saying that this is now case property, because there would be evidence on this and we need to examine this. And they did not even have the sensitivity. I mean, it was so absurd. They did not even see that the woman had nothing else to wear. And her account is that she actually wrapped around the safa of her husband. Safa is a headgear that they wear in rural parts of Rajasthan. It's a huge cloth. And she actually took the safa of her husband. It's a matter of prestige. That safa on the head is a matter of prestige for a man. She took that safa. She had to wrap herself with the safa for her husband to walk back from the police station back to her village. Of course, the case turned into an acquittal by the trial court, and I hear that the appeal is still pending after all those years. But interestingly, on the petition by an NGO, I had to give you these facts, because these facts showed how women, just in the line of their duty, were the feudal society outraged and completely devastated the woman just because she was doing her job. So Supreme Court took cognizance at the behest of an NGO in this matter, and what we know as the famous case of Vishakha, guidelines were laid down to stop sexual harassment of women in their workplaces. The Supreme Court took cognizance of the fact that this is a very rampant practice, and in varying degrees, women, if we have to allow women to be equal partners in the workforce, if we have to allow them really to have equal opportunities in public employment and private employment, it cannot be by them worrying about their safety or any assault on their just because they are of the, a woman or a girl. So taking cognizance of that, the Supreme Court laid down extensive guidelines, and they found a very novel via media and said that, well, we are not laying down law, but we are laying down guidelines which will apply till a law is framed by the parliament, because there is clearly a gap, and that gap has to be, gap cannot be allowed to be till a law is laid down. Of course, that judgment came in 1996, and the law subsequently only came in 2013. That tells you a lot about a lot of things, but let me just leave it there. But Vishakha's judgment, from Vishakha's judgment about sexual harassment, that became a pivotal point, and we saw Supreme Court playing a very aggressive position and a very aggressive role when it came to sexual offenses against women, which unfortunately continue to be extremely rampant in our society. Of course, it's something that happens world over, and it has different geographies, but the same shades, and it's uncanny how gender issues remain the same across geographies. But you know, the entire line and length of Supreme Court dealing with victims of rape, victims of sexual assault. You will remember that there was a time when two-finger test was a norm, which was done by doctors on the victims of rape. And, you know, when it came to evidence, etc., the manner in which the woman, her character was assassinated, it was as if she was, the Supreme Court said that when a woman who has been a victim of sexual assault, when she comes to the court for justice, and when she has to go through the process of the justice delivery, this process actually sees her not as a victim. This process sees her as a accused, as a perpetrator, and the process actually is so insensitive that it adds insult to the injury. The injury has already happened to her in the form of a sexual assault, but the process actually adds insult to that injury. And at various stages, whether it is battering cross-examination by the counsel for the accused, whether it is her character assassination in the court, asking her obscene questions right from the stage of investigation by the police officers, and the whole manner that the doctors performing this two-finger test, whether she's habitual of sexual intercourse. The whole purpose of two-finger test was to see whether she was habitual of sexual intercourse. And these were all practices that the Supreme Court took cognizance of, and with a chisel, they actually chiseled them out and hammered them out, and made sure that when a victim of sexual assault comes in the system for justice, then the system actually treats her like a victim and not like a perpetrator, or not adds insult to her injury, or not rub salt over her wounds, in a matter of speaking. We saw, of course, the Nirbhaya's judgment, and we saw the entire jurisprudence, the entire law around it coming with an overhaul, which was also very, very significant. It was not an overhaul done by the Supreme Court, because it was a law made by the Parliament. So maybe I'm transgressing a little towards the legislature, but it was, sometimes gentle and sometimes scathing dictates by the Supreme Court and various high courts across the country on various of these issues concerning victims of sexual assault, that law had to be forced. And ultimately it was us, it was the people of the country, it was the citizens who stood up and said, no, enough is enough, we can't be tolerating this anymore. And then we saw significant changes, because prior to this, there were only, outraging the modesty of a woman was an offense, rape was an offense, and that's it. There were only two women-specific offenses in the Indian Penal Code, and anything else would be just hurt or assault or battery. But we saw significant changes after the Nirbhaya case, in the definition of rape having been changed. Earlier you had to prove that there was a penetration, etc., and later on with the new definition of rape in section 375, it was much expanded. I'm not going to go there, that's a different topic completely, but just to say that seemingly small offenses, which were taken as, oh, it's okay, it's okay for boys to do it, and it is a mandatory given for women to, or young girls to accept it, like stalking, like voyeurism, like eve teasing, sexual harassment, these all formed as specific separate offenses under the IPC when this amendment came. Acid throwing is also another important branch that saw a lot of attention from Supreme Court. Of course, we've seen that latest judgment of Deepika Padukone, which has a very beautiful and sensitive narration of that story. Lakshmi was that case that Supreme Court laid down extensive guidelines with regard to victims of acid attacks, and we saw that acid attack was not even included in the IPC as an offense. Acid was available freely across the counter, and it had become a tool for jilted lovers, for disgruntled partners, for disgruntled husbands, and many other domestic relationships that women were in. So Supreme Court laid down extensive guidelines going to the extent of dealing with how asset should be sold, how it can be purchased, the putting the onus on the shopkeepers. Of course, implementation of those judgments remain a huge question mark, like implementation of all other laws in our country. But these were extremely significant changes. Acid throwing also became a specific offense in the IPC, and after that Nirbhaya incident in the amendments that took place after that. And interestingly, Justice J.S. Verma, who was the author of Vishakha judgment in 1996, was the head of this committee which recommended these amendments in the law after the Nirbhaya. So that is one line and length of the judgments on gender issues. Of course, when we talk about workplaces, we also have to speak about some interesting judgments in the early 50s and 60s, where, for example, in the case of Muthamma, this was C.B. Muthamma versus Union of India in 1976. It was interesting that there was a rule in the Indian Foreign Service which required a woman employee, a female employee, to get written permission from the government before her marriage. So this was held to be completely absurd, and it was struck down. Then we saw the battle of air hostesses in Air India versus Nargesh Mirza in 1981, where the Supreme Court struck down rules which stipulated automatic termination on the first pregnancy of the air hostess, and called it to be arbitrary and abhorrent to the notions of a civil society. These are some of the interesting landmark judgments. Then we saw, I've already covered some part of these. I'm just running through my list to see if I've left out anything. Dignity of rape survivors, we have discussed. Yes, the triple talaq, Saira Bano, Sabrimala judgments. Yes, what is another interesting judgment that I must point out is Buddhadev Karmaskar versus State of West Bengal. Now, this judgment was also interesting in another way, because Supreme Court was dealing with a sex worker. And it was a very brutal assault, then rape and murder of this woman who used to be a sex worker. And Supreme Court went on to say that, so what if she was a sex worker? Her no also meant no. And she's also entitled to the dignity of living as a human being. And it could not be that her no did not mean no. And just because she generally had it was her livelihood to have sexual intercourse did not mean that it was a blanket yes for all times to come. Another interesting line and length, which also interestingly shows, reminding you of what I said about how the interpretation of the fundamental rights has changed across our different generations, is the entire line of judgments of with regard to adultery. Now, adultery has been an offense in the Indian Penal Code ever since the Penal Code came into being in 1860 and was made by Macaulay. If you see prior to that, prior to 18th century, even rape was considered as an offense not against the woman. It was considered as an offense against the father if the woman was unmarried, and it was considered as an offense against the husband if the woman was married. So with that background, it was treated as an offense which was a deprivation of property at the highest level, because women were treated as property, women was treated as chattel of the men, and that's why we saw that they were not entitled even to a vote. A right of self-determination was unheard of prior to 18th century, but then in different walks of life, with the passage of civilization, we saw women asking for and getting the right of self-determination in various walks of life. It's interesting to follow the journey of how adultery, because it's the same provision that has been challenged and considered, the challenge to it has been considered at least on three different occasions by the Indian Supreme Court. First challenge was from the perspective of treating women as a victim of adultery. So that it was considered as an offense only against a husband. It was not considered as an offense against the woman. I will remind you, the definition of adultery in the Indian IPC, in the IPC is, it's an offense if you have sexual intercourse with a woman without the consent or connivance of her husband. Just look at the absurdity of the definition. So if you have sexual intercourse with a woman with the consent and connivance of her husband, then it is fine. Then it is not an offense. But without the consent and connivance of the husband, it is an offense. So the first challenge was that it is an offense against the woman. It is not really an offense against the man. But the Supreme Court felt that there was nothing wrong with that definition. There was nothing wrong with that. And it was affirmed. The second challenge came in a very different way, where the call was that woman should be treated as an accomplice to the crime, because if she has been she has consented to the act, then and it comes in the definition of adultery, it's without the consent and connivance of husband, then she is an accomplice. She is an equal stakeholder in the crime, and she must be considered as a co-accused or at least as an accomplice in the crime. Again, Supreme Court, being protective towards women, did not find anything wrong in that and refused to look at it. Then 2 years back, we saw, again, the challenge came, Joseph Shine's case. And this time with the, actually, it did not take more than a nudge. And in very emphatic terms, adultery was struck down. They said this, and the whole purport of that judgment is that this section is based on a premise that the woman is a chattel or property of her husband, and it was actually argued on behalf of Union of India that you read that down, you remove the part that can be severed and let that remain as an offense in the IPC. But Supreme Court said, well, we're not going to do that. If you want to come up with the law, it's up to you, the legislature. But in the form in which the law is, treating women only as a chattel and, completely shutting down their self-determination. And interestingly, Supreme Court even went to the extent of saying that sexual autonomy is also extremely important. And the woman has a right of self-determination even when it comes to her sexual autonomy. And voila, we saw the adultery being struck down from the IPC. I think I am quite out of time also, but there is one judgment that I absolutely have to speak about that I have been part of, which Naveen ji also mentioned in my when he was introducing me in the beginning. This is the judgment which we saw just before the lockdown. In fact, there are two judgments. One is the judgment in the case of the women officers of the Indian Army. Second judgment is for women officers of the Indian Navy, which came actually during the lockdown. And the third case is of Air Force, women officers of the Air Force. Air Force case is still going on. We don't have a determination yet because of the lockdown. It could not be heard, but I don't see it going any other way. The writing is clear on the wall with the Army and the Navy judgments and their emphatic determinations. I will tell you a little more about this, because I was I did have the honor and privilege to be part of this case. I had the privilege of representing some extremely gallant women, some extremely brave women of the Indian Army, Indian Air Force, and the Indian Navy, and their experiences and their journeys were it left me awestruck. So this battle actually started in the Delhi High Court. First PIL was filed, then some writ petitions were filed, which culminated in a judgment in March 2010 by the Delhi High Court. The author of that judgment was Honorable Justice Sanjay Kishan Kaul, as his lordship then was. And they said that, women are entitled to permanent commission. Women who are serving as short service commission officers are entitled to permanent commission at par and without discrimination with their gentlemen officers. and the union was directed to carry out the judgment. I must give you a little background. To start with, the Indian Defence Forces did not have women as commissioned women in the Army, Air Force or Navy. This was started in 1991, 1992 on an experimental basis. So first they said we will take women for 5 years, then they extended the period by 5 more years, and then they extended it by 4 years. So a total period of 14 years women were taken, and they continued to serve as short service commissioned officers. And permanent commission was denied. Now permanent commission means that they could serve up to the age of superannuation. In the military, in the Army, Air Force, Navy, there's no fixed age of superannuation, unlike we see in other government services and private services. The military forces are framed very differently, and they have different considerations of a fighting fit army, having being more lean, being more young, and the paramedical structure. So they have different superannuation ages depending on which rank a person retires at. And the superannuation age actually starts from the age of 50 and 52, and then goes up to 62 if somebody rises up to become the chief of the service. So that right was denied to women officers who were serving as short service commissioned officers. They had to go. And that meant that they were not entitled to any pension. That meant that if you were taken in at the age of, say, between 22 to 25, then after 14 years of service, which is at the age of about 38 to 42, you have to go out. After giving the best years of your life, you have to go out, look for another option. And it was actually causing them extreme discrimination, misery, hardship by taking their contribution from the best years of their life and then leaving them. So that was the whole purport of this challenge. There was no challenge to, and I must also point out that women were not taken at that time in all arms. Women in the army were taken in 10 arms, which are all non-combat arms, which are so what we know as combat support arms. So women were taken in those arms. And of course, subsequently, we saw that there were changes made. Navy, Air Force also initially started in different streams, and then they expanded the streams as time goes on, as time went by. And interestingly, it was the experience of these women, it was their service and their credentials which actually forced or allowed the authorities to have women continue to serve. Otherwise, if this would not have worked, if women had actually proven to be bad soldiers in the service of the nation, then this experiment would have ended after 5 years. There was no reason for this experiment to go on for 14 years and then continue to have women for 14 years. Anyways, that is a little background. But then this battle moved to the Supreme Court after the March 2010 judgment. Unfortunately, it remained in Supreme Court for a full decade till we saw the final judgment in February 2020. It was the union's appeal in the appeals in the army matter. They had challenged that judgment, and at different levels, we saw different policy. It was almost like tantalizing that we're coming up with a policy to give permanent commission, and please, you don't adjudicate on it. We are ourselves doing it. They opened it for 2 of the 10 arms, and it kept on going like that. And then finally, we saw that a declaration was made by our Prime Minister from the ramparts of the Red Fort in 2018, the Independence Day, when a political decision at the highest level was taken to grant permanent commission to women officers of the Indian Army. But we felt that we had succeeded the battle, and our matters were still pending before Supreme Court. But when the notification came in February 2019, which was an expression of that political will at the highest level of granting permanent commission, we saw that there was inherent discrimination even in execution of that. So the inherent discrimination was essentially on 2 counts. One was that they wanted to apply this prospectively, which would have left out all women officers who were serving, who had fought this battle, who had been serving for 10 years, 20 years, 25 years, up to 26 years of service they had been continuing, because Delhi High Court had given a judgment and the Supreme Court never stayed it. So they could not remove these women officers, but they did not grant them a permanent commission. They continued to just drag their feet over it. And in 2020, they said that we will apply it prospectively. When the Supreme Court showed their annoyance over it, then they came up with a proposal saying that, okay, we will give it, we will give this to all women who are up to 14 years of service, but the women who have served more than 14 years will only be allowed to serve till pensionable service, which is 20 years, and they will be let go. They will not be given any option of opting for permanent commission. That was one aspect of the discrimination. And the second aspect, very interestingly, they brought in this concept of limiting the women who were granted permanent commission, limiting them only to staff appointments. Now, to those who are not familiar with the military terminology, there are two kinds of appointments, and all posts are nomenclatured as either criteria appointments or staff appointments. In layperson's terms, staff appointments are those appointments which are like less meatier jobs, which are like less. I wouldn't call them lower grades, but they're not command positions. They're not leadership positions. They're not positions of prominence and repute and importance. Of course, all positions are important, but appointments are divided like that as criteria appointments and staff appointments. And to say that women officers would have been confined to staff appointments only would have, and these criteria appointments, in the ACRs, there are different, there's different marking system they have, and without criteria appointments, the women would have been effectively rendered as second grade citizens in the Indian Army, because their chances of promotions, their chances of better positions, their chances of better assignments would have all been completely diluted and negated. So we pointed out to the court that this is extremely discriminatory. You can't bring in a clause of confining them to staff appointment. And that is when we saw that whole, a bundle of excuses that came up from the authorities in the form of a written note that was given at the time of final arguments. And, in a cricket match, it often takes a loose ball to be hit across the boundary. And I strongly feel that in the case of the Permanent Commission for Women Officers in the Army, that note of submissions, which had these bundle of excuses, became the loose ball, which obviously we highlighted. And I'm so proud to say that the Honorable Supreme Court, threw it across the boundary as it ought to have been thrown. So these excuses, you must have followed in the paper, ranged from biologically inferior to physically inferior reasons. They have matrimonial duties. They have, they have motherhood duties. There were very interesting logistic problems. If women are taken as POWs, prisoners of war, then the nation will not be able to take it. Forgetting that women are not even in combat roles. I mean, this case was not about women in combat roles. It is another thing that women have been taken in combat roles by the authorities themselves without any case. And today women are flying even fighter pilots in the Indian Air Force. They are doing seagoing duties. So they're now being considered for submarines also. So it is a progression. But in 2020, a note was given on behalf of the authorities to deny women what? To confine them to staff appointments, not to give them command roles. All these excuses were given that they don't have this. And another excuse was given that the soldiers, the men that they command, they come from that social strata that they will not be able to take command from women. And therefore, this will cause disciplinary issues in the army. And we called out the bluff. We gave examples of how gallant women had performed in the Indian Army. We gave their citations. We gave examples of how incredible the journey of women in the Indian Army had been. How they had been given even gallantry awards, which are not peacetime awards. Gallantry awards are awards which are given in wartime or war-like situations. And women had earned quite a few of them, on the basis of their courage under fire. For example, Colonel Mitali Madhumita, who I represented in another case, her citation read that when there was a Fidayeen attack at the Afghan embassy in Kabul, Indian embassy in Kabul, where she as an education officer was posted to teach English to the Afghan army, She ran in the eye of the storm and she was single-handedly responsible for saving dozens of lives. So that kind of a profile of women officers and in the judgment, actually, Para 76, there is examples of all these women of how they had performed. Ultimately, that entire stereotype was completely shattered by the Supreme Court. Supreme Court went on to say that the constitutional guarantees are sacrosanct to women and they cannot be denied on these stereotypical mindset issues and these these seemingly lower profile or role, lower competence of women. And gender cannot be a disqualification. Women have to be assessed for every role on the basis of a woman. It can't be because she's a woman, she won't be given. She has to be assessed on her individual suitability and her strengths for different roles. Just to touch the Navy case just shortly, I know I'm running short of time. I would like to do questions, but I took time with this judgment. But the Navy judgment was slightly different in the sense that Navy was giving permanent commission to women officers from 2006. So they came up with a policy and they started giving. It was executed from 2008. But Navy took a very novel argument to say that, well, prior to 2006, we were not even giving it to our gentlemen officers. That we were not allowing them to go from short service to permanent commission. And therefore, there's no gender discrimination. Here, we had to use a very novel argument of facially neutral discrimination. There are some legislations or some policies which are neutral on the face of it, but you have to dig a little deeper. You scratch the surface and you see the impact and effect of that. And you realize that it is discriminatory through and through, because gentlemen officers had always had the opportunity to opt for short service or to opt for permanent commission. And officers who had opted for short service, it was not like the option was not available. Whereas for women officers, this option was not available to them till 2006. And interestingly, that judgment also, it is Annie Nagaraj's case, which came in March, again, based on Babita Punia's judgment of the army. And very interestingly, Supreme Court said that battles of gender parity are, they are about confronting the battles in our mind. And it's very interesting because we've seen that gender issues are increasingly taken like that only. So that has been the journey. And to my, I had to finish with this experience of mine, which was, and it's extremely proud moment for me to recapitulate this journey of women, of Constitution and the Supreme Court, and how this beautiful march has been and how this march is going forward. So thank you, Naveenji. I know I've taken too much time, but if we have time for some question answers.
Ma'am, thank you very much. It was like sitting in a flight and you've taken us through a broad contours of time from the 1950s and 60s and till February 2020. Ma'am, thank you so much. It was such an insightful lecture. It is not that the usual thank you that we say always, because you've been a part of it. You've been a person who has actually stood by those women who are brave and valiant. And ultimately, it is because of the efforts and contributions made by you and your team. They've ultimately succeeded, and we have seen such a paradigm shift even in the Indian Army, Navy and Air Force respectively. As you pointed out, for all the advancements that other nations claim, including the US, we have a women president, we have a women prime minister, but US still doesn't have a women president. So that shows the development that we are moving on one side, and on the other side, the challenges that we face. Thank you very much. This was certainly an insightful lecture. All the participants would have been richly benefited out of it. It is a pleasure hearing you, ma'am. And I think we'll take questions. Participants can probably tap it in the chat so that, ma'am, I think the questions are coming in chat, if you can just see.
Okay.
Ma'am, I think there is one opinion. There is a question from Vinodharani where she asks about very minimal representation of women in the Constituent Assembly. She says that out of 389, only 15 were women. Any take on that, ma'am?
Well, we have to bear in mind that this was a time where, though women did play an important role in the freedom struggle. And interestingly, Constituent Assembly did not constitute of elected representatives. These were people who were picked up from all walks of life, who were eminent persons, respected people from their different walks of life to give us a beautiful document in the form of our constitution. Yes, surely the representation was less, but see how representation is today. Another important thing that, important constitutional journey that I forgot was the 72nd and the 73rd constitutional amendments, where we saw, 33% reservation mandated for our panchayats and, so that the grassroots of our representation. It is not like, we can have women paratrooping from top. Even in judiciary, when we talk about, why we don't have that representation of women, there have been women judges that you can count on your fingertips, in the Supreme Court of India. And there aren't too many women judges in the high courts of our countries also. There haven't been. Justice Indu Malhotra was the first woman to be designated as a senior advocate in the Supreme Court. She became the first woman to go on the bench from the bar. So it has been a long journey, representation of women in important roles, whether it was Constituent Assembly that time or even today. Women are today in all walks of life, but not as reflective of what their potential is, but they are more there as individual cases of excellence. That needs to change. Instead of individual cases of excellence, we need to have them reflect as one half of the population of this nation. Swami Vivekananda once said that men and women are like two wings of a bird. And if one wing is very strong, hale, hearty, very robust wing, but the other wing is weak, it is not strong, then the bird may be able to take a flight, but that flight will never be a balanced flight. That flight will never have the equilibrium that a flight ought to have. And it will always be an unstable flight. If we want to allow the flight of our families, of our societies, of our nation, and ultimately the entire Vasudev Kutumbakam, we have to allow one half of our family, one half of our society, one half of our nation, and our Vasudev Kutumbakam to be able to realize their full potential, to be able to contribute in the best manner, not to be bogged down by any disadvantages.
Ma'am, I think the other question was regarding marital rape and its criminalization. Any take on that, ma'am? Of course, no means no, but should this aspect be introspected even in the light of marital rape?
So marital rape, as far as I understand, is being questioned in the Delhi High Court by a petition, and the matter is going on. This has been a matter of public debate of late. I have mixed views on this, Naveenji, and I will share my views for the reason that we can't have the laws thrust on the society when it is not ready for it. Yes. We can't skip a few flights of stairs and go to right up to the top. Of course, in an ideal world, no is no. Yes. And in an ideal world, sexual assault, of course, rape is just for women, but sexual assault should be gender neutral. Sexual harassment should be gender neutral. But till we have that journey up to the ideal world, we have to realize that, today the realities that we have and the relationship of marriage, where physical relationship, where sex is almost like a pivotal point of that relationship. It is a fundamental of that relationship, so much so that Supreme Court has said that a marriage without sex is an anathema, and it is a ground for divorce. It is considered as a matrimonial wrong. It is considered as a cruelty to the partner. So that being the position, marital rape, if we just have marital rape as an offense in the IPC, I believe that it will be like putting a bull in the china shop. We have to get ourselves ready for it. Today, there's a mischief rule of interpretation that we often imply when we come to interpretation of laws. And mischief rule says that we have to go to what was the purpose of the law being made. What was the mischief that the law sought to eradicate or sought to, address? Now, the mischief here is women living in abusive marriages. Let us now see, why do women continue to live in abusive marriages? If we allow marital rape to be an offense under the IPC, you think women will not be able to walk out of abusive marriages? Today, marital rape is a matrimonial wrong. it is a ground for divorce. It has connotations in the alimony, in the maintenance, custody, succession, all of these issues. It is a partially criminal wrong under the Domestic Violence Act, which is a part civil and part criminal law. So we can't say that it's not a crime already. After the 2005 Domestic Violence Act, it is partly criminal actionable. So that is there. But if you have it as a, you know, if you remove the exception in Section 375 of the IPC of a man having sexual intercourse, of course, in the independent thought, that judgment that came of Justice Lokur and Justice Deepak Gupta 2 years back, they have removed that lower age for the wife. So the wife has to be now 18 years of age. Earlier, it was 16 years of age. 15 years of age, right. So that judgment, we saw that change happening. Slowly, we have to come to that. But today, women are not walking out of abusive marriages because of two reasons: social stigma or economic reasons. We have to, we have to develop ourselves to the level of complete eradication of social stigma. I mean, what to talk about marital rape? Today, we don't even have equal rights for women. And our personal laws are the laws. We don't have uniform civil code. We still have archaic practices. I mean, triple talaq just got unconstitutional 4 years back. But there are other very, very abhorrent practices which are there in all personal laws. I'm not just speaking about one personal law, but there are practices which are deeply prejudicial and discriminatory to women in personal laws, and they continue to be. Dowry system. I mean, look at all these the things that continue to exist in our system. So till we are able to fill that gap up, ultimately it should be great. But right now, I don't think we are ready for it. It will cause more mischief than it will cure.
I think just following up exactly on the mischief point, I think there is one question regarding the abuse of these laws that are given for women protection. There are many cases that I think even as a senior lawyer in the Supreme Court, you would have seen in many cases where a disgruntled wife abuses the process. And I think there is one fallout question that talks about false promises on marriage and then subsequent sexual abuse. What is the case? What do you think about this abusive part, ma'am? Because of course, even I have got the opportunity to appear in a couple of matters in Madras High Court and other High Court, where you see that women with great respect, the laws are for them. But some educated women, despite knowing their limitations that they should not abuse it, have abused, and you know that they virtually wreck a family. What is your call on that?
Well, you're absolutely right in pointing that out, Naveenji. I mean, it's not just our experiences, yours and mine. I mean, as students of law and as practicing lawyers, we've all seen and experienced those cases. And we have seen even the Supreme Court talking about it, that dowry laws and these cruelty laws are amongst the most some of the most abused laws in the world.
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, in our country. These are specific to our country. But there's a time again, Naveenji. You know, these laws essentially stem from that affirmative action under Article 15, which gives which mandates the states to make special laws with respect to women and children. So essentially, we have seen the whole genesis of these laws from there. Abuse of a law can never be a ground to throw away the law. You know, that will be like throwing the baby with the bathwater. Also, can we say that, the bride burnings or women dying, jumping in the wells of the houses or women, injecting, consuming pesticides and insecticides as young brides, that is still a reality in the heartlands across the length and breadth of our country. Abuse, yes, there is a lot of abuse happening, but till the time this menace does not go, till the time women are not equals in that relationship, till the time women are not equals in families and societies, unfortunately, we will have to have this special protection of laws for them. And let me tell you, Naveenji, abuse is happening not because of these laws. Abuse is happening because our system has become so slow, because delays are eating our system up like termites.
Yes.
Not just matrimonial laws. You would have experienced there are other people people who are genuine litigants whose rights have been violated. They want to settle out of court. They want to go for mediation, conciliation. But the business community obviously wants to go with arbitration. So alternate dispute redressal has become the norm. It was a sideline, but it has become the norm because the system is just too slow. Of course, our system is one of the most respected systems in the world. Our judiciary is. But what is the point of it when I was reading Palkhivala's book, he defines infinity. The definition of infinity is a suit in one of the courts in India. And we have the dubious distinction of cases being handed down in testaments by generations, that case going on, that so-and-so, whatever is the outcome. So the abuse is not happening because of the laws. I strongly feel that the abuse is happening because the system is, by its sluggishness, somewhere giving a premium to false cases. So if you put a false case, the person who is at the receiving end of that false case, accused in that false case, will go scot-free. But when? After 20 years of facing trial and appeal and going through the whole process. That process would have taken the best years of his life. And if somebody goes to court for the genuine cause, then also it takes 20 plus years for them to finally get out of it. And I mean, we have to seriously think that our system is rewarding false cases, frivolous cases, where people just want to put a case to put somebody on the sideline. So that, I feel, is the reason, and we need to. I think also we need to introspect on our roles. Naveenji, yes. It's not like these clients go on and do cases on their own. Of course, the family court system was contemplated. It eliminated lawyers completely, and we saw a great struggle happening there also. That you have to give legal representation is a fundamental right. But look what we have done. I mean, when a matrimonial client comes to us, we can't be oblivious of the role that we have played. And it's important for us to consider that role, that if there is a matrimonial problem, we will be the first ones to advise, okay, let's do 5 cases. No, one is not enough. Let's exaggerate. Yes. Oh, he has been bad to you. Let's do a rape case on the father-in-law. Let's do a rape case on the brother-in-law. Let's do a 377 unnatural case, a sex case against the husband. Look at the matrimonial FIRs that are being lodged today. So I think our role is something that we need to consider, and we have to consider. Time has come for us to consider our roles in this.
Ma'am, I think we'll take last 2 questions, ma'am. One is on the 33% reservation by the 2018 Amendment Act, which is even in Tamil Nadu, we see that even in a lot of recruitments, a lot of women are coming in. Even in the law school where I studied, it was 52% women, 48% men. So you can understand that you have dominated us. It's the other way around, and we are more than happy to be dominated in that regard. And the 33% is one question, ma'am. And other thing was regarding pay parity. In some cases, women are given less. So I think if these 2 questions, if we can take and we can wind up, it will be great. Okay. We'll pick your response. First on the 33%, if ma'am may give your viewpoint on that.
So I think, Naveenji, it is a very welcome step. When the society is not permitting equal number of women to come up in the proportion that they exist in the society for various different reasons, then reservation as an affirmative action has to be till they reach the proportion that it's not required anymore. We have seen this reservation in the grassroots of our democracy, like I was mentioning in the 72nd and 73rd constitutional amendment. We also saw peculiar terms coming out of that. Especially, I'll tell you from my state again, there is where the post of sarpanch was reserved for a woman, a new post came in, which was the post of a sarpanch pati. And this sarpanch, who was the lady, she would be wearing a full veil and she would be sitting on a side chair or mostly on the ground. And the chair of the sarpanch would be taken by the sarpanch pati, who's the husband of this woman. And even if there were criminal cases that she was facing. So it continues to be lip service in a lot of areas, Naveenji. Look at the battle of women in the armed forces. These are women who, what do they want to do? They want to be equal stakeholders in service to the nation. And they have performed exceedingly well. These are gallant women. These are not, I always say that not everyone has, every woman can become a soldier, but like not every man can also become a soldier. They are of a different metal. They are of a different quality. But again, you see more of them being paraded on Rajpath than being given the equal dues and equal determination. And that's why I shared that journey at some length, that even after the political decision at the topmost level in the country, in the execution, there was discrimination that they had to face. Of course, the next day after the judgment, the Raksha Mantri tweeted and welcomed this judgment and said that he was happy that the women officers succeeded in the Supreme Court. So, and we have seen more women judges in our lower judiciaries, more women lawyers, more public prosecutors, more police officers. After all, one half of the population is women. So we need them to be there to instill confidence, to have, and, maybe physical standards. That's why we have in Olympics also, we have different sports for men and women. There are different entries, there are different tournaments. So physical standards would vary because biologically we are different. But there are lots of areas where women have an edge that biologically they have. What is important is we need to bring in so many women that they come up to the you may lower the standards at the place of the initially because of affirmative action, but you have to train them well, ensure that they perform to the best of their ability, and no slackness has to be accepted at any level thereafter. So equal standards have to apply after giving them a helping hand at the stage of induction. The second issue was, equal pay. There's really no, it continues as a social evil, though in law, in our constitution, and by way of the statute, it is, we are all entitled to equal work for equal pay. So if this is being done, please speak up and please take your case to the courts and you will succeed because this is not allowed in our legal framework.
Thank you, ma'am. I think there was one question with regard to Sabarimala, but as you rightly point out, my matter is in review. So I think it is better that we hold our guns to the debate on that. And of course, you would have heard about the news that one lady judge is being considered for Supreme Court. And if that happens, she might become the first Chief Justice of India. So we are our fingers crossed, ma'am. So hopefully, I think it's such an honor. We have had very eminent participants today. An additional Advocate General of the High Court has participated. And the Vice Chancellor of the Ambedkar Law University, Dr. T.S.N. Shastri, he has also given a comment to me personally on my WhatsApp saying that a wonderful lecture. Please do convey my regards to ma'am. Thank you very much. Ma'am, it was not just a lecture that in its usual kind it is. Today, I think in the question and answer session, you can see that participants have got a perspective and they share a perspective. Ma'am, thank you very much. This shows the number of questions shows how much they enjoyed the lecture. Thank you very much. It's such a wonderful experience for us. I think this is just the beginning of the lectures that you'll be delivering. We'll trouble you often from Chennai. thank you very much. It's a pleasure to listen to you, ma'am. And thank you very much.
It was an absolute delight for me, Naveenji. Thank you for having me. It was really amazing to be with you here.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much. Participants and friends, thank you very much for participating. Please stay tuned for some more action. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.